Hi guys, just a few notes on the really fantastic discussion we've been having in module 3.2 around business objectives versus stakeholder objectives and how the two sort of contrast with one another. And there have been some fantastic examples raised by Inca and many of you inside the forum around some of the challenges that you've had, particularly around some of the challenges around software development, around bringing designers, project managers, BAs, trying to get to the bottom of it, inheriting legacy product, which I think is something that we aren't exploring a lot in the course, but is something that's very often a practical experience and something that I think it's really worthwhile possibly dwelling on for a few moments in this video, just to chat around some of those challenges that come with that additional challenge of inheriting an existing product. What I thought was interesting that came through in the forums was often that there was an assumption or an acceptance that the technology in question was really state of the art, and that the technology, had it been able to follow a proper UX process, would be one in which it would be revolutionary, it would be the absolute best in the marketplace, or something where there was truly like groundbreaking innovation. I think one of the things to not lose sight of is the fact that there's actually an extremely small, extremely limited set of truly innovative software that's out there. Software that could be patented, something that could be, you know, software that could be enforced globally. One of the things that often when we get very, very close to a project as the participants in making that project a reality is we often, for lack of a better word, overvalue the project that we're in, and we don't necessarily see the wood for the trees in terms of the challenges that exist with the software, that the challenges of the product often are insurmountable even beyond what the business is looking for. And often it's important not to lose sight of the fact that the business is looking for something that's going to be economically sustainable. And of course the history of product is littered with fantastic products that weren't necessarily economically sustainable, even where they might have been technologically fantastic. One that jumps to mind for those of us who might have grown up in the 80s was something like Betamax versus VHS in the great videotape debate. Similarly, a technology like Minidisc versus CD. You know, the history is littered with cases where possibly even more user-friendly technology is technology that gets set aside. But I think one of the things that the forum discussion focused on, which was quite interesting, was how different stakeholders are ignored, and that often the business objectives override possibly the usability concerns. What I would say, and what I would like to encourage you all to do, is to look beyond the perspectives that you have come from traditionally. So what I mean by that is, if you've been a developer, the key to understanding UX is not to understand what you've been doing as a developer and how it then relates to the UX process, but rather to understand what perspective is the designer coming from, what perspective is the business person coming from, what are the commercial realities of the software, how much money has been sunk, how long will it take to recover the wealth that has been invested into the product. That can give you a good insight in terms of what features should be prioritized and what features possibly should be de-emphasized. Because there's obviously a commercial and a business reality that underpins every single product that you build out. Similarly, the things that might be the most interesting to us from a product owner perspective, from a project manager perspective, from a designer and from a developer perspective, is not necessarily what is the most important for a user. Balancing those two is a critical part of what our role is as UX practitioners. We need to have a strong cognizance of the technical aspects involved, we need to have a strong understanding of the business realities involved, and we need to go to the users and establish what it is that they really, really want and what they really, really need. And those two are also not always going to be in perfect alignment with one another. In fact, you know, as the old adage goes, there's nothing as unreliable as eyewitness testimony. We have that challenge, which we're going to be looking at in the next module, about how do we establish what it is not only that users articulate that they need, but what is it that they actually need and what is it that they're going to use frequently. In addition, frequent usage is not necessarily the most profitable usage for the business. So sometimes what we as a business might want to do, from a business perspective, might want to do, is look for things that are going to ultimately drive revenue rather than necessarily drive usage. It's a common mistake that's made in usability studies and in user experience design to assume that on both sides of the spectrum, that the extreme applies. So on the one hand, that a good user experience is a minimalist user experience, and similarly, a good user experience is a high interaction user experience. In fact, if we look for pragmatism and we look for balance, very, very often what we're going to be doing is we're going to be saying, what we want to do is we want to have two things that are essentially in tension. We want the user to be able to operate as frequently as they need. At the same time, we want in that frequency that is user-defined, how frequently they need to use the product in question. We want each of those iterations, each of those cycles of the usage to be as low friction as possible. So we want that user experience when it occurs, however frequently it needs to occur, to be as low resistance and low stress as possible. That's the core driver that we're wanting to implement as far as it pertains to the application and the usage of our product. At the same time, I really encourage you to go and talk to the business stakeholders in some of the projects that you guys in the forum have discussed, which have fallen apart possibly in your company and in some cases have been scrapped. I would encourage you to go and talk to the business decision makers who made that decision of it being scrapped, if possible. In fact, I can say to you that there are a couple of things as a business stakeholder myself in my own business that you might find, you might be surprised by how the empathy for that business stakeholder's problem is appreciated by that person. So if that person hears you saying, well, why did we can that project? What were the reasons why we ended up not doing it? What were the business realities that made it unsustainable? What was the client finding that were causing them to step away and feel that the product no longer made sense? So often when a project comes to a close, and an unfortunate close, often the designers and the developers and many of the people who have spent a tremendous amount of time with the product forget that there's a whole set of disappointment that's coming from the business side, both from a commercial point of view, but also from a vision and leadership point of view, that often there's a tremendous amount of disappointment that the product is come to an end. And understanding that is a great way of preventing it having to get to that point. So if you understand the commercial realities that are underpinning the development of your product, you can take those into consideration when you're designing it, when you're building it, when you're architecting it, so that you can avoid the business realities overcoming the usability goals. And in fact, I would argue that the only way, if we consider ourselves to be advocates for the user, the only way for the user to obtain and use with a frequency of their choosing, the only way for them to use and obtain the product is for the product to be economically sustainable. And therefore, it is a core tenet of usability for us to understand what are the commercial dimensions behind it and how can we use usability design to facilitate and ensure that the product comes to market in a sustainable and achievable way. I want to thank you all for your contributions in the optional discussion. It's been really, really robust. I'm really glad to see that there's a tremendous amount of experience in the class. Some of you have said, you know, you haven't had the pleasure of interacting with a client yet before, and I want to suggest to you that you try in whatever way possible to get involved with client discussions, even just as a wallflower initially, someone who's just sitting in the back of the room, to see how those client relationships are handled. Some of you also noted that sometimes it's client account execs who are managing the discussion with the client, and the designers not getting to deal directly with the clients. As someone who spent many years in an agency, I can tell you that that often is the case, where a client service acts as a buffer between the productive capacity, which is often the most expensive part of the business, and then the client. And that that buffer, I think, and striking the right balance between how you manage the relationship versus how you deal with briefing people, is it relates to the core commercial challenge. If you allow a client to have unfettered access to designers, to UX designers, to product managers, to software developers, you'll often find that the budget gets blown out of proportion, and that the client wants access to the resources that are going to allow them to create a great product. But at the same time, they might not necessarily have the budget to have that level of access. And I think striking the right balance there is critical. I would encourage then, if you're in an organization where client service is being used to regulate that consumption of resource, to encourage your client service team, your client service director, your business unit directors, to allow some engagement, controlled engagement, that's also a billable engagement to the client. So the client understands that the more interaction that they have with the developers, the more interaction they have with the UX team, the more interaction they have with the designers, there needs to be an additional premium paid for that, because that's an opportunity, essentially, if we're using an agile methodology, it's an opportunity for things to adjust, and then in that adjustment, the costs to change. Look, it's a fascinating topic, and I know we're going to be discussing it in the future modules as well. It's an ongoing challenge that comes with being a UX practitioner, but what I would really encourage you to do is to understand all sides of this problem and not look at it purely from your own perspective, but really try and understand each of the different dimensions that come together in building a great product. And I look forward to continuing this conversation with all of you. Thanks.